each other a happy Easter. And so, as you come out for communion, I'd ask that you respect each other's distance. When we have communion, all you have to do is take a Kleenex from the aisle, put it in the palm of your hand, and I will put the wafer into your Kleenex. So as you depart today, make sure you're doing that and keep each other safe. Are there any other announcements anybody can share? I do give thanks to the people that return the offering bags that we collected during Lent. And we still have the Lector collection that's going on. And also, if you're still interested, at the Willow Street entrance, as you're leaving today, there's some slate from the roof that is still there. First come, first serve. Whoever takes it, it's yours. Because it's just going out the door. It's right now at the door. Next week it'll be outside. So please, if you're interested in some of those slates, please take them with you. Not seeing any else or anybody jumping up, let us now prepare our hearts and prepare our minds to worship our Lord this day as we prepare with our prayer.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory.
Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father,
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us.
You alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord.
It's Easter baskets.
I mean, I wrote these and put everything in a basket. Can any of you see an Easter basket? There's one there. There's another one. They're not going to go ahead, are they? I did that on purpose. It's real simple to find them. They're right there, 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 and there. You know why I made it so easy? Because the Easter message shouldn't be hidden away. The Easter message is about telling people and rejoicing that Jesus, who is dead, is now alive. And we rejoice and we want to tell everybody. We don't want to hide it. And so that's why we have Easter and we have these celebrations. And that's why we have the baskets of all the goodies. It's to rejoice and give thanks for all the sweetness that God loves us. And so I invite you, as this part of this, is to take one of those baskets with you. If you can find them. And you all find one? You can take one. And thank you very much for coming up. You can take a basket with you. Thank you. This will be a while. We haven't done it in a while. You two want to come up now? You can go get one. Maybe afterwards. You still don't want to come up.
Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them. I will. St. Paul wrote, "Now, I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaim to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which you also are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaim to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I, in turn, have received, that Christ died first in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am who I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe the word of the Lord.
Let your steadfast love come to us, O Lord.
Save us from the promises. We will trust in your word.
The Holy Gospel for this Easter Sunday is taken from St. Mark's 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome bought spices so that they might go on and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man, dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, who has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he's going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May the words of my mouth and the ears of our hearts be open to the word of God this day. Amen. He is not here. He has been raised. Those are strange words to hear if you're visiting a cemetery. You go to a cemetery expecting to visit the dead. You don't expect to hear, "He's not here. He is risen." That would be shocking. That would be startling. That would be scary. I mean, we understand what a cemetery is. We go there and it's a place of memories. Sometimes peaceful sadness. Just picture going to Mount Olivet or resting. You see the great markers of friends That's not what you're expecting here. That's not normal. You go to the cemetery, you look at the stones, and you see birth and death. When was the last time you went to the cemetery and looked at one of the stones and said, the birthday, a dash, the day of death, and then another dash that says, to eternal life? That's not what we normally expect. We look at birth, we look at death. Death is being the end. That's what we're used to. But that's not what happens on this Easter. That very point of that extra dash to eternal life, death being just the beginning, is what takes place. And that's the glorious message of Easter. That's why we gather here. That's why we have faith. If Jesus were to die and was buried and still in the grave, our faith would be pointless. It'd be meaningless. If you were still in the grave and there was no resurrection, 2,000 years would have gone by and no one would remember it. But something happened that Easter, that death was not the end. Normally, up to this point in all of humanity and everything we know, death is the end. It tells us that death is the end. It is the final step. And that's what they expected on that dark Friday. Jesus had been nailed to a cross. The women were gathered nearby, wailing and crying, looking on. Around him in that darkness that had descended are his tormentors. They're mocking him, hurling insults at him. They're asking him, well, now that you're up on the cross, are you now going to rebuild the temple in 3 days? They look up at him and say, if you save others, why can't you save yourself? They mock him and they revel in his pain as he suffers, trying to breathe his last. Finally, hours after this torment, Jesus cries with a loud voice and breathes his last. He has died. It is over. Death had won. Or so they thought. The crowd started to disperse. The onlookers go away. The women still stand at a distance, crying, tearful. They watch as the lifeless body of Jesus is taken down from the cross by the Roman soldiers. These soldiers who are trained at killing, who have to guarantee with their lives that he is dead. They have checked. Jesus is dead. They stabbed him in the side. He is dead. Their reputations as soldiers, their very lives depend upon it. They did their job. Jesus is dead. Everyone knows it. They lowered his body to the ground. They allowed Joseph of Arimathea, with the help of Nicodemus, another member of the Sanhedrin, a rabbi, people that had hoped in Jesus as the Messiah, came and they take his lifeless body off the cross, removing the 6-inch nails. They hurriedly wrap him up in linens and pour some ointment and carry him down the hill from Golgotha toward a nearby grave, to a hollowed-out tomb. They lay his body in that grave as the women cry, standing nearby watching. These men silently roll the stone into place. It drops into its slot. It seals the grave. They stand silently while the women cry nearby. That's all they can do. Jesus is dead. He is buried. The Sabbath is coming. Sunset is coming. It is over. Or so they thought. They leave that night thinking that he is dead. know that they're great, and we know that death is the final slip. Or so we think. For one continues in chapter 16, saying, after the Sabbath, when it was early in the morning, when it was still just safe for the women to go outside the city, they leave the city walls to go out to go to the grave. They're still expecting to go to a cemetery to see death. They're not thinking he's not going to be there. They're not thinking that he's risen. They're not remembering any of those words. Their major concern is to correct what the gods did and heard, as women like to do. Correct what the men did. The men did it on Friday night right before the Sabbath. They hurried through it. But now the women have time. They want to go to the grave and properly bury Jesus, wrap his body, pour the ointments, prepare for that final say for death. Their biggest worry is who's going to remove the stone that is dropped into the slot, that massive stone that seals the body in. They're not sure who's going to open it, because they know it'll be there. They're certain it'll be there. Jesus will be there. And then they arrive. They get to the grave, and the stone is rolled away. They go into the grave, and one like an angel, an appearance of an angel, sits to the right side of the grave and says, the one you're looking for, the one who is dead, who was crucified, Jesus of Nazareth, he is not here. Look, he has risen. This changes everything. In this moment, everything gets changed. Up to this point, death was the final say. Death had the final curtain. We all understand that. We know that. Even when we lose people to death, we mourn their passing. For a time, we have keepsakes, we have memories. But death does have that final say. After a generation or two, the keepsakes are gone. A generation or two more, and names are forgotten. A couple more centuries, and the graves are even gone. They are forgotten in history. The dead are forgotten. That's what we know. That's what we believed, and that's what they believed. But in this moment, everything changed. Because Jesus was no longer dead. He was now resurrected. He was alive. This changes everything for all times. That there is a resurrection over death. And Mark ends his gospel with a message that he gives to the women. That angel says to them, go and tell the good news. Go and you will see him. Mark actually began his whole entire gospel. His very first line of his book was, this is the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ. And now he ends with the good news going into effect. This is where the good news begins. Up to this point, it would not matter. But because of the resurrection, it is the good news. That death is not the end, it is the beginning of eternity. It is the beginning of God's kingdom. It is the beginning of the fulfillment of the life everlasting with all the saints. That is the good news. And the women are told to go and tell. And go, and you will see him. Mark ends it there. There is no resurrection stories. Mark, being the earliest gospel writer, wrote with this quick ending. Later on, if you look at Mark, there is a little bit more added to the book. But most experts say that it was written later by other authors. And added to the book because we don't like that kind of open-ended ending. We like to match the gospels of Luke and Matthew and John, who has the visions of Jesus and the resurrection. times the disciple saw him in the upper room. The story of doubting Thomas, the road to Emmaus, beside the seashore of Galilee. But Mark doesn't end it that way. It's as quick. It's as simple. He is not here. Go and tell the good news. Go and you will see him. I think Mark leaves it that open-ended way because it is an ongoing story. It is a never-ending story. It is a story that in death just begins. It doesn't end there. It begins eternity. And that same message is sent to us to go and tell that story. The good news of Jesus. Even because Jesus or Mark didn't share any of those stories, we know that they happened. We know it took place. Because these disciples went and told. They weren't scared. They were hidden away. They were frightened for their lives. They thought they might be killed next. But something amazing happened to them. Something that woke them up and emboldened them with the Spirit to go forth into the temple, into the streets, into the cities throughout the Mediterranean, sharing that good news. They went and they told the good news. Death is not the end. We have seen the resurrection. And in their time, they had seen Jesus, and they would see him again. The same message is for us. And we are to go and tell this good news. Death is not the end. Our tombstones do not end at death, but they have that additional dash. Dash to eternity. We continue on to God's kingdom. And we will go and we will see him. He will be with us. And he will call us by name. And we will join with all the saints in his eternal kingdom. Mark leaves it open for a purpose because that's the message of, that's the good news of Easter. That it's not the end. That it's just the beginning. It's just the beginning. Go and tell this good news. Go and you will see him. The resurrected Lord. The life everlasting. Go and tell. Go and rejoice. Celebrate this day. You will see him. He is with you now and forever. Amen. And may the peace and grace of God be with you this day and throughout this week you come. Amen.
Come on, Jesus, come on, come on. Lord,
chiefly we are bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Lord. For he is the true Passover Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sins. The body of death has destroyed death, and by his life has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene, with Peter, and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, with cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join in our unending praise. Let us now pray. Lord God, fill us.